Yeah, let me start my talk with the more or less trivial observation that machine learning is everywhere and has become a commonplace in our daily lives. So it might seem really trivial, or there's no point in saying that, but it might be a useful, maybe scaring or shocking exercise to take the time and reflect, each one of you, each one of us, how much machine learning might have actually decided our life. So as an example, the very fact that I stand here has to some extent, or to a very large extent, been decided 8 years ago by a machine learning algorithm when I was looking for tenure track positions, and I used an academic job site to look for positions, and some machine learning algorithm on this job site decided or predicted that I might be interested in a job ad for a tenure track position at Aalto University. And at first, I was not really sure, because I must admit at that time I have not heard about Aalto University, which is not too surprising because it was established only a few years before, but also I had no personal connections here within my research network. It was really out of the blue, a machine learning system on this job site suggested to me or predicted that I might be interested in this tenure track position. Well, and you see now the result, standing here as a tenured associate professor. So to some extent, the fact that I'm standing here as an associate professor at Aalto University has been decided 8 years ago by a machine learning system that predicted that I would be interested in this job ad. So beside professional life, also your private life might have been already decided or largely influenced by machine learning. So maybe some of you like me have used dating sites to find interesting people, and these dating sites also use machine learning to predict which user profiles you would be interested in. And also some bit less than 8 years ago, one of these predictions was the profile of my wife. And yeah, we are now happily married for several years. So beside my job, also my marriage has been to some extent decided by machine learning. But also, aside these long-reaching decisions or influences, on our everyday life, we are constantly provided with predictions for what to consume next. So which movie to watch next, which video to watch next, which song to listen to, which product we would like to be interested in. And all these applications use recommender systems. And these recommender systems, they are largely based on machine learning. And maybe some of you had these ambivalent moments where they have been presented a new song or a song that they like from the first tune, but have not heard about before, ever. So there would have been no way to dig up this song from your own collection, but you like this song immediately. And such moments, they can also be scary because they hint at the potential of machine learning to profile us, to really profile us to a very much level of detail. So here's my Schwarzenegger slide picture. One might wonder if we're already controlled or ruled by machines. And I let you answer these questions, each one of you, for yourself. If you remember, for example, if you came here today by metro, and when you think about a typical scenario, where very few, if not any, human being is not constantly hooked to a smartphone which delivers predictions or which delivers content that is chosen or decided by machine learning apps. So now, after all these observations, the next question is then, of course, so how does it work? And most of my research and teaching revolves around the questions of when does it work? So when does machine learning work? And how can machine learning be successful? And to answer such questions, we need, of course, theory. And theory is based on a language. So we need a more formal language to reason about machine learning applications and methods. And it might be not too surprising to most of you that the key component, or maybe the main component of such a language and theory of machine learning, should be data. And it is actually not too trivial, or it's not so trivial, to come up with a widely applicable, precise definition of what we mean by data. So some people might define data as bits or anything you can store on a hard disk, but I think this is way too narrow. This is only a subset of data. And while teaching thousands of students here at Aalto from all kinds of different fields, I found it useful to take a more generic approach and to define data as a collection of or set of data points of a similar type. So for example, data points could be human beings such as me, Alex Jung, and this data point carries information in its properties, such as age, nationality, and university degree. And some of these properties are more or less easy to look up or inquire. Many of us nowadays are not really shy on sharing information or features about a person. And in academia, we also do this in a very routine way using curriculum vitaes, where we share our properties. So the ultimate goal of machine learning systems, is to predict other properties. Properties of a data point that are not so easy to look up or inquire. And one such label, for example, for the data point Alex Jung could have been 8 years ago, is this person interested in a job ad for Aalto University? And what machine learning methods do, they try all the time to find better and better hypothesis maps that allow to predict the label or quantity of interest of a data point based solely from its features that we input to the model. So yet another machine learning problem that I would like to briefly touch here is chatbots. So when you use a chatbot such as ChatGPT, you generate data points in the form of prompts. So here a data point is a user prompt. And this user prompt is characterized by the text, like a sequence of characters that we input to ChatGPT. So what ChatGPT, or the machine learning behind ChatGPT, does is it tries to learn a hypothesis, a map, that reads in the input and delivers an output in the form of a response to your prompt. And hopefully, this response is good or useful. So a machine learning method tries to find a hypothesis out of a set or space of different hypothesis maps, which we call a model, best predicts the labels, the quantity of interest of any data point based on its features. The important thing here is any data point. Not only the data points in a training set, but any data point you can think of. And to evaluate and choose between different hypothesis maps, we need a quantitative measure for the prediction error. So we need to measure how well are the predictions, or how good are the predictions. And this measure is called a loss function in machine learning. So it seems a mouthful to claim that these modern large language models, deep reinforcement learning methods, under the hood, are all based on the same curve-fitting principle as linear regression. But it turns out they use the same. You can use similar optimization methods, optimization algorithms, for these different methods. So in these methods differ mainly in the choices for the data points, what they use as a model to represent hypothesis maps, and how they measure the quality of predictions using loss functions. So in general, different machine learning methods are obtained from different design choices for data representation, model, and loss function that is used to train the model. And much of my research and teaching is devoted to analyzing this three-dimensional design space of machine learning methods and to find out useful similarities and fundamental differences between all these different machine learning methods. This three-component picture of machine learning not only allows for a systematic study or mapping of the machine learning landscape, but also can serve as a conceptual basis for the design of machine learning systems. As machine learning engineers, our goal is to build systems, machine learning systems by combining suitable design choices for data, model, and loss in order to meet explicitly defined design criteria. And this design criteria might include computational complexity of the resulting machine learning smartphone app, as well as the accuracy or predictive power. Indeed, we want our machine learning apps to run in real time and not empty our smartphone battery within 10 seconds. And we're also not too happy with machine learning systems which have a low accuracy, so which basically suggest songs to us that we never like, or suggest user profiles to us that we never like. So we want them to be accurate. However, there is now an increasing attention also in another dimension or another criteria, which is the ethics or trustworthiness of machine learning. Besides these computational requirements and the amount of training data, I also want to briefly discuss the requirements for the trustworthiness of AI methods. And one such important requirement here is explainability. So we not only want predictions by a machine learning method, but we also want explanations. So think about a movie night with your spouse, and you're using your favorite streaming app, and the streaming app using also a recommender system, using machine learning, which predicts that now you should see an app for a dating site. And your spouse might then wonder, why are we seeing this ad here? So the prediction here should always be accompanied with an explanation. And in this case, the explanation was because of the daytime and the location of the computer that used the streaming app. So this was a good explanation in this case. Okay, so just to wrap up, I want to highlight again there are important trade-offs between the different design objectives for machine learning methods. And it is up to us, machine learning scientists and engineers, to negotiate or to trade off these different design criteria and to basically choose which of the following two future scenarios we want to end up with. So the first scenario is the pessimistic outlook, where largely unregulated machine learning systems use us humans as resources, as batteries. So I have here used the picture of a battery. I could also have used the picture of an oil barrel. So each human would be an oil barrel. And instead of oil, we carry data, personal data. The more optimistic outlook is that we will be able to ensure good use of machine learning technology that provides us with very much needed services like healthcare in very aging or highly aging Western societies. Okay, and I'm deeply convinced that our ability to make good use of machine learning crucially depends on how well we educate our societies about the basic principles, opportunities and risks offered by machine learning. And one of the important missions of public universities like Aalto here, in my opinion, is to provide this education in highest quality and as freely as possible. And I want to thank Aalto University here to give me the opportunity to contribute to this mission by teaching some of the largest and most important courses on machine learning right from my start as assistant professor in 2015. And as mentioned, as a byproduct of these teaching efforts, I'm also quite proud to have authored the first machine learning textbook from Finland entitled Machine Learning the Basics, which has been published last year. Thank you for your attention.